So good day, everyone. I'm Teacher Christine, and I will be the first presenter for today. And the topic that we will be discussing is supporting learner participation in managing learning environments. So the lessons to be covered are the strategies for building a productive and positive learning environment that I will present. And the tips and strategies for building positive learning environments will be presented by Teacher Joanna and Teacher Annalyn. Okay, so strategies for building a productive and positive learning environment. So why do we need these strategies? Why do we need and how can we build a productive and positive learning environment? And however, will we be able to benefit our students? So to answer these questions, let's imagine the classroom as a theater stage, all right? And the students, our students, are the actors, and we're the directors. So we teachers are the master of the play. We create the lines, the actions, and the stage for the actors to attain their maximum performance. And for this, we prepare our actors to perform to a certain standard that we're the ones who set. And we teach them how to speak, how to think, and how to act, the basics on how to perform well and to reach the standards that we're putting up for them. But of course, in order to do this, firstly, we have to design the stage that wherein they will perform. We will design the arrangement of the props, the backgrounds, the lighting, as well as the cues that will help our students or our actors to know how to interact with the audience and their fellow actors. And of course, creating the stage environment is crucial in ensuring that the actors feel comfortable to bring out their best performance. And in the same way, we design the topics, activities, and the classroom environment to maximize the learning potential of our students. As teachers, we must establish the stage of the classroom because it will be the one determining the student's academic, emotional, and social success in school. And what is a positive learning environment anyway? So, positive learning environment. So, it is an environment that establishes a brave space wherein students will be able to take risks and to have open, authentic conversations that they will not be scared in opening up or in doing or in saying because they know that they will be respected, that they will be supported, and that they will be received well. And if we foster trust and respect, all of which are supported through positive interactions within the classroom, then it will create a space that will be conducive in learning for the students. It can improve the students' academic performance and as well as their social and emotional well-being that not only is limited inside a classroom, but also it can be extended to the real world. So how will we create a positive, productive learning environment? So we have 6 steps. The first step is making learning relevant. So as teachers, of course, we must know who our students are. We should know our students' needs, learning styles, interests, and talents. Because this way, we can use certain teaching methods and strategies in creating these learning experiences that they can resonate with. Because if we're able to show our lessons in a creative manner, then we will be able to pique their interests, right? We can create these activities that they will like, that they would want to be engaged in, that they would want to participate in the learning process. And the second step is to develop a code of conduct. Because teachers, we should know how to establish a code of conduct. It's basically the 10 commandments inside the classroom, and we must ensure that there is a mutual understanding of what we consider as positive and negative behaviors inside a classroom. It is to avoid the conflicts between students, because if they have different understandings, they will behave differently from what is the norm or what is agreed upon. So what we can do is to ask the students to brainstorm the behaviors, the actions that they would want to be treated, or how they would want to be treated and how they would treat other people. These actions must be respectful, this must be kind, fair, and appropriate inside a classroom. And here we can see the different examples of classroom code of conduct posters that can be put up on the wall so that it will serve as a reminder for students on how to behave. The third step is to employ a positive actions curriculum. So our students come from diverse cultural and socioeconomic backgrounds, and this is a factor that can influence how they would perceive things, what behaviors they think are appropriate, are positive or negative. So we must have a teaching system for the students to know what positive behaviors are, so that we'll be able to successfully establish a positive learning environment for the students. Because a learning environment is not just established by the teacher. It's a collective action. It's a collective effort that everyone will partake in, so that the positivity will be maintained inside the classroom. So the positive action curriculum is one of the most effective ways to teach students positive behaviors. It teaches the students the following: positive actions lead to good feeling and positive self-image. Positive actions lead to positive behaviors, which help children feel good about themselves and others. So of course, we feel better about ourselves when we do positive things, not just to ourselves, but also to other people, right? The next is positive actions, such as goal setting, lead to personal growth and improvement. Positive actions, such as problem solving, decision making, and thinking skills, develop the brain and make us smarter. So we want the students not to stay as mere students. We must transform them into learners. We lead them to this path of self-improvement until they can stand on their own feet to find their pace as they grow and hone their own skills. Because our roles as teachers, of course, is to just ignite the potential that is deep inside in these students and to make them bloom, to ignite them and let them keep it burning. Next, positive actions such as nutrition, proper exercise, and sleep that lead to a healthy body. Next, positive actions such as time management and managing our emotions help us better manage our own affairs. Of course, this talks about discipline. Being disciplined in handling our own emotions and actions will give us the sense of self-control to help us in managing our lives, our day-to-day lives. And it is up to us to take care of ourselves. We must know what positive actions and behaviors that we can do that will benefit us in maintaining our overall well-being. And positive actions, such as admitting mistakes and taking responsibility for our actions, allow us to be honest with other people and ourselves. So, internalizing positive actions and making them second nature to us will help us in cultivating our relationships with other people. And to do this, we must remain empathetic and to treat other people the same way that we want to be treated, as per the golden rule. And for the fourth step, help students develop intrinsic motivation. So what to remember is that when a student has a positive thought, it can lead to positive action, which produces positive feelings. And this positive feeling of doing something positive to other people will serve as the intrinsic motivation for the students. We can teach them to engage in positive actions more if we explain that their thoughts turn into actions and their actions will influence how they're feeling. If they have positive thoughts, they will produce positive actions, and that can make them feel good about themselves. However, if they have negative thoughts, then they will not feel good, because it will only lead them to do negative actions that will not make them feel good. So teaching this to the students will be a powerful motivation. It will motivate them to turn every negative thought into a positive one. And for the next step is reinforce positive behaviors. So recognizing and reinforcing positive behaviors produce positive actions in students, strengthen intrinsic motivation, and create a productive and positive learning environment. And one way that we can do this as teachers inside the classroom is we must establish a reward system. So we must recognize and reinforce these positive behaviors and achievements through giving certificates, stickers, toy prizes, tickets, tokens, or even food, right? And apart from that, of course, we must remember that we must instill the connection between positive behavior and good feelings so that these students will not just do positive behaviors for the prize, for the physical reward that they will have when they behave well. And for the last step, always respond with positivity. Positivity is one of the most powerful agents for change, for establishing and maintaining a positive learning environment at school and in the classroom. So as teachers, we must always interact with our students in a positive manner. We must exhibit positive behaviors and, of course, to maintain a positive attitude to establish a positive learning environment. Because teachers are the role models inside the classrooms, right? And we are the models for the students. So we must show them first what we want them to learn from us. Because positivity is very important. It's crucial. It's the key component to a positive learning environment. And it's a powerful attitude that students can bring with them, not just in the classroom, but also wherever they go and whoever they meet. So that's all for the strategies in establishing a productive and positive learning environment. And the next presenter would be Teacher Joanna. So take it away, Teacher Joanna.
So after discussing the top 6 best strategies that can be utilized by teachers to create a positive and productive learning space that will increase the class participation among students, we will give you more. So more strategies that are simple yet effective and useful to develop students' social, mental, and emotional well-being, leading to the advancement of their learning experiences. So we all know that their school is their second home. So it is our responsibility as a teacher to create a kind of space where they can comfortably and freely express themselves, form a bond with their peers, classmates, friends, and teachers, and also develop their self-confidence. So the first strategy is to build a relationship first, and the school will come second. Of course, we need to make sure that students are well prepared and energetic mentally or even emotionally before, during, and after the class discussion. So one example of this is by having a mini games or mini energizer before the class starts. So letting them engage for a while and have fun with their classmates or friends can boost their energy. It will also lift their mood or ease any fears or pressures they may have felt the first time they have entered the classroom. So we need to allow them or give them some time to adjust and familiarize with their environment. So it is said that students learn best if they see their surrounding positively, a place that is supportive, welcoming, and safe. So sometimes we tend to be more focused on the lesson content, leaving the classroom management behind. This is not a wrong approach, however, you should also consider the consequences, especially to how the students will learn and grow their interest in this kind of environment. So second strategy is to share some stories from the summer, which can be utilized by teachers before the transition into the school year. Actually, I find this activity a very interesting one, especially if you want the students to get out of their comfort zone. So asking simple questions such as, what did you do during the summer? Did you went on a vacation with your family or did you spend your time playing with your friends? So what are the most unforgettable experiences you have gained during the summer break? So something like this that will help them learn and understand the lives of their classmates is a great way to establish the special connection between them. It will also help them feel that they are not alone, and because of this, they will slowly develop their sense of belongingness. So emphasizing the value of openness to listen to other stories, as well as the willingness to share your stories too, that are full of joy or adventure, is a great way to establish or build a good rapport with your students, which is useful in the long run. So the third strategy is getting to know each student. So our learners' parents have the vital information about the students, which we don't have. They are more aware of the child's interests, abilities, skills, hidden talents more than us, which is necessary for their development, right? So of course, we should always seek for their help to properly assess that kids individually. So each of the students learn differently, and we must always consider that when developing and organizing classroom management and learning pedagogies to ensure that we will meet the educational goals. So various ways that is proven effective to communicate with the parents is by asking them to write a short letter describing their child. So in this way, we will be able to know how the students are different from the others, and we will also know their capabilities. So the fourth strategy is by writing an introduction letter. So this is the most common activity, especially during the first day of class, right? So students are required to properly introduce themselves to everyone so they will know who she is or who he is. So sometimes as a teacher, we are not only asking them to state their name, their address, their age, or their gender, but we also ask some important details such as their talents, their skills, their abilities, their strengths and weaknesses. So it is important to remind them that introduction is not all about answering the questions, but it will also break the ice in the class so everyone will feel comfortable in their environment. So for the teacher's introduction, this is the most crucial part, because how you will introduce yourselves in front of the students will be the basis of their impression about you. So one example that can be utilized in this strategy is by giving an assignment in the class where they are required to introduce themselves to you in a manner of how they want you to see them as a student that is different from everyone. So the sixth strategy is by creating an internet meme. So of course, we need to add a twist to make our learning fun, interesting, and unique. So given that we are teaching a 21st learner century, it is vital to incorporate a strategy that will improve their creativity and develop their digital literacy skills. So aside from that, it will also influence the learning outcomes, because if they find the activity or the lessons related to what they have seen somewhere, especially on the internet, then it will pique their interest as they can connect faster. So to make this work, you can simply search the most popular meme on the internet and think of a humorous line where you can connect your class rules and expectations. So here are some examples of the memes. So one is, dear teacher, I talk to everyone, so moving my seat will not help. So this is a meme for the students who are very talkative. So the next one is, when you remember an answer after you have already turned in your test. So if you are a student, this is the most frustrating that will happen to you. So the next strategy is to lean on your colleagues. As a teacher, always remember that there is nothing wrong in asking help from someone who you think is more knowledgeable on the field than you. It will allow you to improve your skills throughout the process, which you can apply on your pedagogies to achieve a better learning outcome. So the significance of seeking help is that it fosters collaborations within the group, as the teachers are able to share different strategies that they employ inside the classroom to create a positive and productive learning environment. So peer-to-peer learning is also beneficial, as it allows you to acquire new set of skills and knowledge, apply this in the actual field, get some feedbacks from the teachers, and reflect on it. In this way, you are able to determine the areas that need to be improved and strategize to deliver it successfully on the next try. So the seventh strategy is to plan for the future and live in the moment. So it is critical for the teachers to arrange everything ahead of time. The pedagogies or methods that they want to adopt, and also the materials that they are going to use for teaching, should be appropriate to their lesson matter. It is not a one-sitting task for which you will simply spend a small amount of time for planning. You must evaluate a lot of factors that influence the learning instruction, including the needs of your students and how they learn the best. However, you should not only focus on the learning outcome, because you will still achieve it if you have a well-structured plan. The most important thing here is that you enjoy, learn, and experience new things in the process. You should not only create a learning experiences for your students, but you should also construct your own. So the 8 strategies is to get the students involved in the process. So in the process of learning, if there is a parent involvement, of course there should always be a student involvement, as they are the ones who will acquire the necessary skills and knowledge. So in planning the classroom, it is important that as a teacher, you can maximize the student engagement by giving them the freedom to design the classrooms or change the setup depending on their preferences. It is important that we consider the kind of environment that they want to have, a space that will increase their motivation and confidence. So simple changes like arranging the furnitures, the chairs, the tables will have an impact to the learning outcomes and class involvement. So making them your partners in managing the learning space, even if it's simple as asking their suggestions or what they think about your plans, embodies a meaningful student participation. So another strategy to build a positive and productive learning space is to have your students create their own bookmark in a creative manner. It contains information about you, such as your name, your contact number, and the school URL webpage. So in this way, they will stay in touch with you, especially if they need your help for some matters. It will also enable them to connect with you and to build a positive environment that fosters trust and respect. So if they feel that they receive so much support and care from someone, then they are more likely to stay motivated, which is will improve their class participation. So it is significant to maintain an open communication with your students and always avoid building a wall between you and them, because it will impede the students' learning achievement. So the 10th strategy is to create a classroom newsletter. If you have no idea what this is, a newsletter can be in a form of printed or electronic report that delivers important and relevant information, such as news or updates related to an organization or a business. In the classroom, it can also use as the students' communication tool to convey their thoughts or ideas about these certain topics. However, one of the problems that we usually encounter when we use this as our medium is that it often don't get read. So creating a classroom newsletter that involves a student-driven project can build a productive and positive learning environment. Let the students work on it, and we will only serve as their guide throughout the process. Inform them that they can make an invitation to a class activities or projects, or it can also be an announcement about the upcoming events or meetings. So the 11th strategy is to connect using the social media. So this strategy is relevant right now, of course, since we are in the pandemic. Teaching the students is done online, so it is vital for us to explore all the available resources that will help us stay connected with them virtually. So the most common social media that we are all familiar with is the Facebook. We can do a video call with the students, create a blogs, and of course, stream live lectures. And for the students, they can create their own posts to share their assignments or projects so everyone can see their works. So this became our new classroom, and as a teacher who is new to this kind of setup, we still need an adjustment, same to our students. So we need to ensure that we have the background knowledge about the different kinds of social media, especially the Twitter and also the Instagram, to create a more meaningful learning experiences. Also, it is an advantage for everyone as we will be able to develop our digital literacy skills, given that we, as their teacher, have the responsibility of informing them about the expectations, limitations, acceptable and not acceptable when using online platforms. So this is the example of the online etiquettes, which you can post inside the classroom so the students can read and understand how to be a digital citizen. Okay, so this is the top 11 tips and strategies to build a positive and productive learning environment. So I will now pass the next presentation to Teacher Annalyn, because as promised, we will give you more. So this is not the end, because we want you to learn as much as possible. So Teacher Anna, it is your turn now.
Thank you, Teacher Johanna. So to add to what Teacher Johanna discussed, I'll also share some other simple tips and strategies for creating a positive learning environment. So first, create and maintain a classroom blog. Creating a classroom blog is another great way to keep students and teachers up to date and involved in what's going on in the classroom. In that blog, teachers can post class announcements, prompts, resources, upcoming projects and assignments. And it's also a good space for students to collaborate by sharing their ideas there and providing feedback on each other's work. Next, keep it green. Use digital technology to decrease reliance on paper products. Imagine how many papers and pages we are wasting just on printing and photocopying materials. Gratefully, much of what was traditionally communicated using paper can now be communicated online using Facebook, Twitter, or a class webpage. So teachers should learn to utilize and encourage students to use some free websites and applications to download, share, edit, and distribute documents. Going digital saves time and may help in protecting our environment. Next tip, start with relationships. Teachers need to focus on establishing relationships and building a sense of community within their classrooms. Try doing some team building activities. We know that team building activities and games are designed to solve problems and collaborate with others. If we allow our students to engage in these kinds of activities, it will be a perfect time for them to know each other more, build trust with one another, and of course, have fun. Next, another tip is to be enthusiastic. Teacher enthusiasm is generally recognized as one of the most essential and desirable characteristics of effective teachers. The mood of the teacher will dictate the mood of the students. Student engagement depends on the teachers and their attitude towards teaching and what's going on in the classroom. So a teacher's positive attitude and enthusiasm are crucial to creating and maintaining a positive learning environment in the classroom. So following this tip to be enthusiastic, you should also stay optimistic. We know that students are different. Each of them has different perceptions of success and failures. Some may be weaker than others in accepting failures and disappointments. So your ability to have a positive attitude and stay optimistic is at the core of your ability to establish a positive learning environment. So next strategy, treat each student as if they were your own child. Treat each of your students with the same love, respect, and level of attention that you'd want for your own child. As teachers, we are considered second parents, so students should feel safe around us, and we must think of their welfare before our own. Next, focus on the positive. many believe that there is something positive to be found in even the worst student. So it is better if teachers can find something good in each student each day and point it out to them. Focusing on the positive in every student will enable you to create and maintain a truly positive learning environment. Another tip. Sometimes, just wing it. No matter how well you planned over the summer or your vacation, once the children arrive in the classroom, you start getting to know them. You really can't make a concrete plan. So take a little time to get to know your students. After the first few days of school, you may need to reevaluate your plan and fix a few things. Just have fun, it's okay. Winging it in the classroom is a method that some teachers do use, whether it's because there was no time to plan or they prefer to let the students dictate the class the entire time. Yes, it's necessary to have a plan. You can plan, map, and research all summer, but anything can happen once those kids get in the room. So striking a balance is the key. Next strategy, review the basics. Academics are important, but it's challenging to create an effective learning environment if students don't know proper classroom etiquette. Don't assume that your students know anything. Review the basics. Reviewing the basics sets the stage for a positive and productive learning environment in the classroom. Next tip or next strategy, reconnect at the beginning of each year. Teachers can plan a school-wide social event or activity to be held the week before school starts. This provides students, teachers, parents, and faculty the opportunity to reconnect without the pressures of school. It's also a good way to strengthen relationships with students and parents. Without a solid foundation in relationships, quality learning is impossible to achieve. And lastly, establish positive parent relationships. At the beginning of each year, reach out to the parents of each child in your class in a personal way. Introduce yourself, let them know who you are, that you're excited to start working with their child, and what your plans are for the year. By having more conversation with parents, teachers can learn more about students' needs and their home environment. And this information is a great help for teachers to have an idea of how to approach the students and plan strategies to provide and meet those students' needs. So, those are the simple strategies and tips from teachers, educators, and even parents for creating a positive, productive learning environment at school and in the classroom. Let's remember that classroom environment is one of the most important factors that affects student learning. An ideal learning classroom is where students view their classrooms as positive and supportive, a space where learners feel safe, involved, and secure. Given that teachers have the biggest role to play in a classroom setting, it depends on them what strategies to apply and what kind of learning atmosphere they want to create. In a positive learning environment, learners are more likely to have higher motivation, leading to more promising learning outcomes and best learning experiences. So that's it for our discussion for today. Again, this is Teacher Annalyn with Teacher Christine and Teacher Johanna. Thank you for listening.